الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين والمبعوث رحمةً للعالمين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحابته ومن اتبع سنته بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، we started last week to talk about understanding Islam. While the title seems to be addressing a basic simple issue that we are all Muslims, we know what Islam is, we know the pillars of Islam and the pillars of faith, we know our deen. Why are we talking about this? We're actually talking about this topic because our reality reflects that there is a lot of misconceptions about Islam. And I'm not talking about non-Muslims misunderstanding Islam. I'm talking about us, Muslims. I am talking about how we behave and why we behave the way we behave in a way that leads our ummah where it is today. The premise is, the assumption is, and the basis of this discussion is, Allah told us in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَظْلِمُ النَّاسَ شَيْئًا. Allah never wrongs any human being. Nothing. وَلَكِنَّ النَّاسَ أَنفُسَهُمْ يَظْلِمُونَ. Instead, people do injustice and wrongdoing against themselves. So when we look at the situation of our ummah, we know that Allah would not put us in this position despite our commitment to Islam, nor would He do that despite our discipline in practicing Islam, nor would He do it despite our efforts to learn and teach Islam to others. This is an ummah whose security, the security of its existence, is hinged on its practice of its faith. It's an amazing formula. Our existence is tied to our practice of Islam. Our practice of Islam is tied to our understanding of Islam. And the result of our understanding and our practice are tied to our commitment. How much do we commit to Allah? How much are we disciplined in our practice of deen? And when we see our situation, an ummah that is relegated to the backdrop of history, to the backdrop of civilization, that means something is wrong with us. And what does this have to do with misunderstanding Islam? It has to do a lot, because we keep asking Allah, we keep praying to Allah to give our ummah this and this and this of dignity and honor and victory and high place in history and leadership of other nations. How could He trust us with any of that or bless us with any of that if we do not have the level of commitment and the level of understanding that would make us fit leaders, first for ourselves and our next following generation, second for people who do not know Allah, people who do not know faith and belief and commitment? So if their misunderstanding is leading them to reject Islam as a whole, Our misunderstanding of Islam leads us to alienate ourselves from Allah, to become strangers to Allah, or to put Allah in a little corner in our life. When we need Him, then we desperately need what we want from Him. And when we feel we can live without Him, life goes on. We can ignore Him. We can live according to any other set of principles or rules other than His. And we feel we are still Muslims despite what we're doing. So Allah tells us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُوا مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah would never change the conditions of any nation or any community unless and until they change what's in themselves. Why then understanding is important? Because misunderstandings and wrong conceptions about Islam lead us to practice culture in place of religion and call it deen. So we're calling our customs and cultures and social heritage as deen, and we're practicing that. But now it became lately very dangerous, because even our culture has been subordinated to imported cultures. So it's not anymore even the social norms and cultures that were produced as a result of Islam and some other things. No, now it is complete subjugation to imported ideas, imported concepts and philosophies that is shaping our thoughts, shaping our choices, and shaping our behavior and our character. So as Muslims, our deen is not clear in our head. Our commitment is not deep in our heart. Our relationship with Allah is an opportunist's relationship, meaning somebody who only relates to Allah when he thinks he needs Allah. So he prays earnestly and eagerly and sincerely. But when he feels that he can do without, he is easily distracted by anything. We spoke about life's distractions a lot. We're distracted by our hopes, our dreams, our aspirations, our fears, our worries, our anxiety. We're driven by our needs for food, clothing, money, shelter, rides, cars, all of the things that Allah has facilitated for us are more of distractions to us than they are reminders of who the giver is. And that's a big flaw. It is a flaw that reflects how childish we have been, acting like children. You give a child something, he takes it, he runs, he's playing with it. And he forgets to tell you even thank you. It's not in his grain, and the toy you're giving him is so glamorous, so attractive, so full of lights and whistles, so he takes it and runs, he's happy. We should understand how the Quran describes this life so that we are not distracted by life and what it offers as children are with their toys. Allah describes this life as a toy, a play. إِنَّمَا هَذِهِ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا لَاعِبٌ وَلَهُ. This life is nothing more than a game and a piece of fun or entertainment. This is dangerous to be the habits of adult Muslims. let alone children who are growing, especially in this society, focusing on nothing but whatever seems fun according to them. 99% of the choices of our youth is based on what is fun at the expense of what? What is in their best interest? What can advance their interest in this life and in the hereafter? And it is very sufficient for them that they enjoy what they have and aspire to what they want to get, all based on the measurement, the yardstick of whether or not it is fun to have, it is fun to enjoy. So Allah keeps giving and forgiving, and we keep getting and forgetting. We need to remember this. We need to remember this. When Allah gives us, there is a reciprocity, there is a reaction that we have to have. Allah says, لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you become grateful, if you offer gratitude, I am going to increase what you get. So when we act like children, take what He gives, and forget or ignore or neglect to offer Him gratitude, don't cry foul when He doesn't give you as much as you want, or exactly what you want, or the time when you want, or the amount that you want. Something is going to change. So instead of changing it to the better by offering gratitude on the spot, on time, we say Alhamdulillah, but only as a lip service. We don't really look deep at what it takes to get something to your hands from Allah, a divine gift. Let's talk about some of those gifts. You see, when we become sick, we pray and we ask everybody around us to pray. We ask even our enemies to forgive us and pray for our cure because we are desperate. But do we do the same when we feel we are already cured, the treatment is working, the disease is subsiding or fading away? No, we don't. Why? Because our concept is Allah, and this is what we want to treat. Allah, for the majority of us, is a standby God. He's just one call away. It's like a child when he is in trouble. Whom does he call? Mommy, Daddy, please help. So we're dealing with Allah as an available standby resource. Not real God, not real giver, not real caretaker, but as a standby. When we need something, we'll call you. And this is wrong. The Quran says that this is not the attitude of the believers. And Allah in the Quran tells us an example of this. حَتَّى إِذَا كُنْتُمْ فِي الْفُلْكِ. As long as and until you are on the ship. وَجَرَيْنَ بِهِمْ بِرِيحٍ طَيِّبَةٍ. And the ships are sailing with good winds. وَفَرِحُوا بِهَا. They are happy. Things are running our way. MashaAllah. We're very happy. And MashaAllah. جَاءَتْهَا رِيحٌ عَاصِفٌ. Gusty winds started to come in. And high tides started to seize the ship. وَجَاءَهُمُ الْمَوْجُ مِنْ كُلِّ مَكَانٍ وَظَنُّوا أَنَّهُمْ أُحِيطَ بِهِمْ. And they think and believe that they are gone. they are sieged, they have no escape to go to. Then what do they do? دعوا الله مخلصين له الدين. Then and only then they pray earnestly to Allah, invoking their faith. Oh Allah, we believe in you. Oh Allah, we trust you. Because it's a crisis. It's a crisis. We will get to the description of that. This is called in the Quran, Ibadatullahi ala harf. You are worshipping Allah, but you are standing on an edge, on a cliffhanger. When you are on a cliffhanger, you need the hook to keep you safe. So they earnestly pray to Allah, if you would only save us from this one time, we will forever be grateful to you. لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ فَلَمَّا أَنْجَاهُمْ مِنْهَا إِذَا هُمْ يَبْغُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ. When Allah saves them, gives them relief of that situation, they go back to their old ways, committing transgression and wrongdoing, and forgetting the commitment they made to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In another ayah, Allah describes the same, saying, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَى حَرْفٍ. Some people worship Allah, but only on a cliffhanger relationship. You know what a cliffhanger is? Cliffhanger is a hook that mountain climbers use to keep them safe. They have to anchor it in the mountain to stay safe and to keep hanging. Without it, they fall and they are dead. So some people worship Allah and their relationship with Him is like a mountain climber on a cliffhanger, على حرف, about to fall. فَإِنْ أَصَابَهُ خَيْرٌ اطْمَأَنَّ بِهِ. When something good befalls him, he is happy. I am happy. I deserve it. Allah blessed me. But it doesn't change their life or their relationship with Allah and their ways of dealing with their faith or even people. وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ فِتْنَةٌ. If he is tested by any tumult, fitna, calamity, trial, or test, انقلب على وجهه. He turns his face upside down. He is, literally speaking, throwing a tantrum at Allah. You know the child, when they throw a tantrum at their parents, they club to the earth and they put their face to the floor. انقلب على وجهه. He turns his face upside down. He is in a tantrum situation. Oh Allah, why did you do this to me? Oh brother, see what Allah did to me. But you know, I do good. I am good. This. As if he forgot what he claims to believe in. Allah never wrongs any human being. People wrong themselves and they wrong each other. We commit injustice, not Allah. So we should never blame Allah for what we get. So this is another misunderstanding, that we deal with Allah as if we are the boss. When we ask you, Allah, we want you to answer. But when you call us, you are quite merciful to wait for us until we come. And in reality, Allah is way more merciful than we think. But the attitude here is taking Allah for granted. This is what the Quran is talking about. Don't take Allah for granted. Don't take Allah's blessings for granted because He can take it away. He can take it away. And He will hold you responsible for every gift. We are using all what Allah gives us as if everything is literally and absolutely ours. And that's another misunderstanding. It is my money. It is my this and my that. As if you have absolute control and possession over what you have. While our faith, the Quran tells us that everything you have will be taken away. Either that you will be taken away from it, or it will be taken away from you. Nothing in this life is stable but change. Change will continue to happen. Nothing is stable in this life except one thing: the relationship that you set with Allah and with stable people who believe in Allah. Those are constantly stable based on three factors: your commitment to this relationship, your discipline in the relationship, and your nurturing of this relationship. Without those factors, any relationship is subject to change as well. So because we are not created as stable souls, our faith decreases and increases. Our faith in our heart, it increases at moments and it decreases at moments. Some days you feel highly spiritual, highly related to Allah, closer to Allah than ever, and those days are known. Most of us feel the same way in Ramadan or maybe at 8 times. But the rest of the year, it looks like we are in a desert, in a desolate, arid desert, dry, without cultivation, without water, as if we have no source to nurture our existence. And I'm not talking physically, I'm talking spiritually. So we end up feeling alienated from our faith and from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Until we stabilize our relationship with Allah, we will always be shaky. And that shaky position is what leads us to devastating ailments and diseases and trouble, from worry to anxiety to depression to other things, even more serious things. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advises us, orders us to hold tight, all of you together, to the rope of Allah. This is the source of stability. Your anchor in this life is how much you hold on to the Quran, especially when you are living on a cliffhanger. When your life is threatened, you resort to the Quran and to Allah. But why is it that as an ummah, our existence is threatened and we still have people among us who believe in ways of life other than Islam? They believe in secularism, they believe in absolute liberalism, they believe that the Quran is too old a book to offer us guidance for contemporary issues. As if they were deaf and blinded from all the developments in Islamic literature done by our contemporary scholars who have faced and tackled every problem that all other communities have failed to tackle, all based on the Quran and the Sunnah. The Quran doesn't give us details by way of Allah being merciful, and by the nature of the Quran as a pragmatic, flexible source of guidance. Pragmatic, it gives you something logical and practical. But also, it gives you spiritual guidance. So not only to tackle your tangible physical needs in life, but to keep the source of connection, of stability between you and Allah, always in touch with Allah. Your spirit, this is the core of who you are. You are primarily a spiritual being. Without the spirit, you are nothing. هل أتى على الإنسان حين من الدهر لم يكن شيئا مذكورا. Has it ever come a time when man was nothing to mention? Nothing. Yes, there has. When Allah formatted Adam, shaped him from dust and water, and developed that clay, before he had blown into him from his spirit. Who was Adam? What was Adam? It was nothing to mention. A piece of clay. No more, no less. Nothing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he blew into him from his spirit, he turns from a dead mud into a living, vibrant, influential, and powerful being. The most powerful creation of Allah is man. But Allah is more powerful than all and any that He creates, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we need to change our misconception that our life is as material people think it is. وقالوا إن هي إلا حياتنا الدنيا نموت ونحيا وما يهلكنا إلا الدهر. There is nothing to it. There is nothing to this life but living and dying. There is nothing after that. There is nothing behind that. This is the material people. But how is it that we Muslims are spending 90% of our time, if not collecting positions, counting the positions we have, and if we don't have positions, we spend our time crying for the positions we don't have. Brothers, we have to change this. We have to live as Muslims. If you hold on to the rope of Allah, your life will be different because your thinking should be different. The ideas that come to you would be different. The way you sort these ideas and start to develop actions will be different. Your choices will be different. But so long as we lead a casual life rather than a deliberate life. A casual life is life as it happens. Whatever comes, I deal with it. A deliberate life is a life that is based on principles, goals, and objectives, and a mission that you live for, and a faith that you want to secure. This becomes a deliberate life, meaning a life in which you plan and craft your destiny with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This becomes a Muslim life. Allah says, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَبِذَلِكَ أُمِرْتُ وَأَنَا أَوَّلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. And I am the first of Muslims. Say, O Muhammad, صلى الله عليه وسلم, that my prayer, the highlight of worship, and my sacrifice, and my way of life, my lifestyle, my living, and even my dying, all of these areas are what? لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. I am living for Allah. I am here as His servant. I am here to do His will. I am here to obey His commands. I am here to listen to His word. I am here to benefit from His guidance. I am here to help His creation. I am here to live life better than what I got when I came here. I am living on a track, and my track is the path to Allah. قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي. This is my path. This is my path. My path is to Allah. So I am tracked like a train, and the end station is to arrive in submission before Allah. This is how a Muslim sees his or her life. Otherwise, they lead a casual life, a life that is full of distractions, full of disobedience, and we still think we are good Muslims just because we have limited Islam to what we do of prayer. While prayer is central, very important, but at the same time, it does not do for the rest of what Islam is to submit the whole of your life, the whole of your position. All of your positions, you will leave behind. You will be taken away from your position. Many people think we are only concerned about the other way around. We are more concerned about our wealth be taken away than we are concerned about us being taken away from our position. It doesn't concern us much. We think we're living until 80, 85. Some people plan for more. And they think that it is logical. There is nothing in Islam to prohibit you from planning to live 100 years or more. But which is more worthy of your effort? The life of eternity or the limited life of 100 years? That concept has to settle in our heart, in our head, so that we lead our life accordingly. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to understand Islam and to increase our commitment to Islam and our discipline in practicing Islam. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا مولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله وبعد. Brothers and sisters, the people of Shu'aib, the community of Prophet Shu'aib, when he started to give them da'wah, calling them to submit to Allah and to worship Allah, he was also telling them to practice justice in their business and to consider the principles embedded in their faith when they practice their business. أوفوا الكيل والميزان ولا تبخسوا الناس أشياءهم. Don't sell people short of their positions. Don't do injustice to people when you conduct your business. So they raised a question. They said, O Shu'aib, أَصَلَاتُكَ تَأْمُرُكَ أَن نَتْرُكَ مَا يَعْبُدُ آبَاؤُنَا أَوْ أَن نَفْعَلَ فِي أَمْوَالِنَا مَا نَشَاءَ. Does your faith, and they use the word salah to highlight faith, because salah has always been the most important, obvious, visible pillar of faith. After believing in Allah, salah comes immediately there. So they ask him, does your prayer, which means does your faith, command you, Shu'aib, to tell us to leave out the worship of our gods that were worshipped by our parents? Or does it tell you how we should use our wealth, our money? Is this what your faith is about? And definitely, a faith that doesn't tell you how to lead your life to win on the day of judgment, please turn off your cell phones. Thank you. So, a faith that doesn't tell you how to lead your life successfully and win on the day of judgment is incomplete. And Allah told us in the Quran, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ. Today I have completed your faith for you. The guidance I intended for you is all in your hands. There is nothing missing. You need not to look out of the Quran for any guidance, nor should you borrow anything from anywhere, because it may run against what is in the Quran. So whenever you need guidance for any question, for anything, look in the Quran first and foremost. And if you have not learned the Quran enough to know where to look, ask a scholar. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask the people of knowledge if you don't know. But don't judge on ignorance. Don't judge on haste. Don't judge based on desires, because all of these judgments will take us away from the Quran. So there is a lot of misunderstandings that we need to consider so that we can live a life of deliberation, a life of thoughtfulness, that we consider Allah before we make a decision. Inshallah, in a week from this Sunday, which will be Sunday the 26th of October, we are hosting a fundraising for the National Coalition to Protect Civil Freedoms. I'm going to quickly tell you what this organization is composed of to know what this organization is after. It is the American Muslim Alliance, a political lobby in Washington, Bill Rights Defense Committee, which speaks for itself, Center for Constitutional Rights, a very famous non-Muslim organization stationed in New York, Creating Law Enforcement Accountability and Responsibility, that's another organization, Committee to Stop FBI Repression, something Muslims are very much concerned with, Defending Dissent Foundation, the right to object, the right to say no, another organization, This Is Rising Up and Moving, DRUM, another organization, Friends of Human Rights, International Action Center, Islamic Circle of North America on Social Justice, Muslim Civil Liberties Union, Muslim Justice Initiative, Muslim Legal Fund of America, National Lawyers Guild, which is one of the largest lawyer organizations in America, National Liberty Fund, Peace Through Justice Foundation, Project Support and Legal Advocacy for Muslims, which is acronym is Project Salam, United National Anti-War Coalition, one of the largest organizations fighting against war and violence, Universal Justice Foundation, which has led the defense for many of the Virginia 11 defendants 14 years ago when 9/11 took place. So brothers and sisters, these organizations together formed a coalition so that they become more powerful than working as individuals. And they asked Dar al-Hijra to host a fundraising for them here. Last week I asked for your support, but most probably I was wrong. I needed to tell you what the organization is before I ask for your support. We got 40 some promises, only 22 people purchased the tickets. The tickets are only $30, which is nothing. But we need 200 people to attend this event in this place. Not this Sunday, but the following Sunday between Maghrib and Isha. I hope the message is clear. If you need to read about this, the brochure and the tickets are available in the office. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to do what is right for us. what's right for our children, what is right for our fate in the hereafter. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت، وعافنا فيمن عافيت، وتولنا فيمن توليت، وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا، غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا، وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان، واجعلنا من الراشدين فضلا منك ونعمة. اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها، وزكها أنت خير من زكاها، أنت وليها ومولاها. اللهم أحينا مسلمين، وتوفنا مسلمين، واحشرنا مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين، وحسن أولئك رفيقا. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات من كل ذنب، فستذكرون ما أقول لكم، وأفوض أمري إلى الله، إن الله بصير بالعباد. وأقم الصلاة.